Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, dear friends, it's sometimes a very ungrateful situation to open a conference in the second morning after a successful opening night, especially when it starts at 9 o'clock. But I'm really overwhelmed that so many people came here. It's a very big hall we are in, but I think the topic we are talking about, I think it needs a big hall, because it's a very big topic. I'm very glad that I can be here today to open the second morning of the conference European Angst, together with my colleague Michael Metz, the Secretary General of the Danish Cultural Institute and acting president of UNIC. Europe plays an important role for the Goethe-Institut. It is part of our written statutes. It says, as a German cultural institute, the Goethe-Institut also sees itself as a European cultural institution. It works in and for Europe. Against the backdrop of recent crises, it is reinforcing its European initiatives and promoting an awareness of European citizenship through its cultural projects. It advocates the common European cultural space, which is based on cultural diversity and independence. That's our statutes. For over a year, the discussion in the Goethe Institutes about dealing with the current situation in Europe has intensified considerably because of the strengthening of populist tendency and ideologies in numerous countries, including our own. Ideologies that claim to be the true voice of the people against a so-called elite. Ideologies and tendencies which, reinforced by current refugee and migratory movements, stir up the fear of foreigners, question European integration, and campaign against cultural diversity. We are experiencing how the ideas and the vocabulary of populist movements penetrate mainstream society and attack the values that we, the Goethe-Institut, stand for, the values of freedom, of justice, and the wealth of cultural diversity. Europe, with all its crises, mistakes, and challenges, is our home. That is why we are watching the present situation with great concern. For these reasons, as a German and European cultural institute, we increased our efforts in Europe this year in order to respond to the new challenges. In our programs, we are concerned with reflecting the present situation, responding to the fears, encouraging young people, and I know that there are many students here, to raise their voices for free values and strengthening the cultural stakeholders who are coming under pressure. Today, our conference on European Angst plays a special role within the scope of the numerous events organized by the Goethe-Institut on the subject. European Angst is a genuinely European event, and I would like to thank my colleagues from the Istituto Italiano di Cultura, the Polish Institute, the Alliance Française, the Czech Center, the BOZAR, the European Movement, and of course from UNIC for their good cooperation. As the name implies, my colleagues in Brussels are using the conference European Angst to get to the bottom of this undefinable fear that is spreading like mildew across our communities. This angst that we all know is becoming an underlying emotion for an increasing number of European citizens in the face of a complex global world. It is the root of rejection and anger and the gateway to populist ideologies that offer supposedly simple solutions. How close and real this fear is. On Sunday evening, I telephoned with my mother. My mother is 82 years old. She had to flee from her own homeland when she was 10 years old, and we discussed about the Austrian presidential election, about the discussions in Germany which are going on in the political field. She said, the brutal language and the aggressiveness of political discussion frighten me. On the same hand, a German newspaper article about a refugee from Afghanistan being suspected of an act of violence also made her uneasy that evening. On the one hand, we must take fear seriously. And especially in Brussels, the heart and head of the European Union, we also have to ask uncomfortable questions. The populist candidate did not win the election in Austria, but almost 47%, or almost half of the society, voted for him. How do we deal with these dividing lines that are digging deeper and deeper into our societies? How do we prevent European citizens from feeling left behind and lost in a complex world? How do we reach a consensus, find a positive European narrative that unites us instead of dividing us? How do we approach those who, organized within closed peer groups on social media, call serious news channels the lying press, Lügenpresse, and elected politicians the system? How do we deal with the post-factual world, perception that values negative feelings more than facts? How do we take away people's fears? Today's panel on racism, the role of media, and the reflection on methods and narratives to counter extremism and European disintegration explore these questions. On the other hand, after my really big disappointment over the Brexit referendum and the sheer astonishment on the election of Donald Trump as the next American president, the Austrian election also gives us hope. Because it mobilized many Austrians who did not vote in the first election to now vote for the liberal candidate, for Europe and against populism. They took a position because they became aware that the European achievements of peace and freedom cannot be taken for granted. They see those people who voted. They see that the commitment of every individual is necessary to preserve and further develop what we have accomplished in Europe. They realize that the populists do not represent the people, but that we all are all the people and have a voice. We, artists, cultural stakeholders, institutions, have a special responsibility to reinforce these people and must take a stand. A stand that is committed to the values of freedom, justice, and diversity. Thank you very much. I wish us a good conference and give the word to my colleague, Michael Metz. Thank you.
Well, good to see you all again. Those of you who were here yesterday, I decided yesterday, after having participated in the afternoon session, that I will use this occasion to follow the directions given in the program for this conference, that was to leave the comfort zone of the liberal consensus. I thought we missed something yesterday. We got a long way. But the diagnosis of our current problems is not yet clear. So I thought I'd use this occasion to kick a couple of points into the debate. I will do it in very simple, blunt language. As a former diplomat, it's my experience that diplomacy really doesn't work on occasions like this. So my first question is, what kind of shit are we actually in? How deep are we in? Is it dangerous? And could it maybe serve as a fertilizer for something positive? Let's start on the first one. How deep are we in? What kind of shit are we in? One thing that we missed yesterday was the economic aspects of the background factors for the present number of crises. Globalism has led to an explosive growth, also a growth in difference between rich and poor, between the very rich and the very normal people. According to my textbook in financial theory, an economic policy that promotes welfare should make sure that the winners of the economic competitions compensate the losers and still come out as winners so that everybody wins. What has actually happened in the real world is that the winners keep it all and the compensation mechanisms do not work. Now that has led us to a situation where the richest 1% of the population in the US from 1980 to 2015 grew its share of the net national income from 8% to 18%, in the UK from 7% to almost 13%. No wonder people feel cheated, and maybe we should discuss things in terms of less growth and more fair income distribution would be much better for the quality of life of the majority of people. The loss of trust, the loss of confidence, the loss of cultural values seems to be one of the consequences of a tough globalization with the inequalities that has brought with it. On top of that, you see the migration issues, you see the security issues, you see the populistic issues, and all of it fed by a society that is tending to break apart because of a very, very increasing distance between rich and poor. How deep are we in? Well, we're so deep in shit that we have forgotten to talk in civilized terms about other people. We have brought ourselves into a track of conversation that reminds me of Klemperer's fantastic book about the lingua terti imperii. We seem to be talking about each other and to each other, not as equal human beings, but handling each other with disrespect and not realizing that we actually belong to the same flesh and blood, and that we all have equal dreams of safety, livelihood, and happiness. Nations have been pushing the problems behind us, and we have been pushing each other into situations where we have ended up both harming our own interests and the interests of those people who seek refuge in Europe. We have been heating up the temperature of xenophobia and nationalism. Maybe apart from the Germans or the Swedes, the rest of the European states have just closed their doors. We have deepened the problems in Greece and Italy, and we are looking inwards instead of looking outwards. The European attempts to find common solutions are hampered by the short-sighted nationalistic points of view from almost all member states. So we are deep in. Is it dangerous? Yes, it is. If we lose our basic sense of solidarity between member states, the basic solidarity to share burdens and find common solutions, then we lose the empathy that is necessary and should be expected from a continent that more than most continents has suffered from our own internal historical mess of civil wars, world wars, and accompanying challenges much larger than the ones we're actually facing today. The European values that we pretend to share are being eroded by our lack of political action that should actually reflect the values, even eroding some of the core principles of the European Union. And if those values, reflected as they are in our culture, in our arts, and in our political and social culture, are not able to guide us to work together on vital common issues, then what is under pressure? The values, the way we work together, or maybe both? Is there hope? Yes, there is hope. But I think we should be better at spending common energy on finding common solutions and maybe move out of the naval-focused but interesting intellectual debates about values and spend more time on doing things together. Show it is the relevant way to do it. Don't tell it. The election of Trump underlines the importance of doing more in Europe and doing more together. It's a wake-up call. It leaves everybody with food for self-critical thinking. We have to reinvent the cultural sector from within, and we have to develop the cultural sector's potential to become an agent for societal change. If we in the cultural world remain inactive, I don't think anything good will come out of the present situation. The cultural world has to be in the front, and we simply have to get our act together. The answer is to improve cultural cooperation as we work on in UNIC, as we work on with our cultural colleagues. We know that the kind of political Pavlovsk reflex of the political establishment is to focus on both strengthening and deepening of Europe. Yesterday we heard the expression, let's get more Europe. Fine, but it doesn't look as if it's working very well. So maybe it's not the same kind of Europe we should beg for. More Europe should be a Europe that focuses not automatically on increasing military expenditure, on safeguarding a currency that is not necessarily seen as the backbone of everybody, and then a few semi-non-emphatic things on these refugee and migration issues. We need to set a new agenda that also contains our basic European emphatic values and becomes possible for creating platforms of inclusion and not just platforms for the political and economic elite. These issues are much too important to be left to politicians. We have to take part in that process. And just as war is too much important to be left to generals, we as people of culture have an obligation to move ahead with very specific and direct cooperation to help our dear Europe to come out of the present shit. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael Metz, for this very undiplomatic call for action. I think what we're going to do today is spend one last day on debating things, and then from tomorrow on, we're going to take this into account and start with the action plan that Mr. Metz has so eloquently put ahead. Good morning, everybody. My name is Sascha Lienartz. I'm your host today for the remaining day of our conference. And I'm just going to do a quick reminder for those who haven't been here yesterday how this is going to work. The main idea of this conference is to involve more than 40 students from various countries in our debates with our panelists. So what we're going to do is we're going to have three panels here, and the students are divided in three smaller groups, and around about 10 of them are going to participate actively in each panel and going to engage and discuss with our panelists. The three debates are going to be about 45 minutes with the panelists. Then we're going to have a short period where students are going to intervene and participate in the debate. And then it's going to be an open floor for questions from the audience. I think we have a very exciting program ahead of us. We have three very different and distinguished panels. We have a couple of technical challenges ahead, and we're going to see how that is going to work, because our first panel is going to involve a Skype connection, so hopefully everything's going to work properly. What we're going to have is panel number one. working on the topic of scapegoating and abordering the question why racism could gain so much ground and how it feels to be a migrant in contemporary Europe. And we're very pleased to have the Dutch sociologist Paul Scheffer here, who's going to try to establish a connection with a participant who's based in Berlin and who can only participate via Skype. That is Firas Alshater, also known as Zukar, a Syrian migrant living in Berlin and having established an astonishing number of people following him on his YouTube channel, where he's describing his experiences in Germany. That panel is going to be moderated by my colleague Isolde Charim. We're going to have a short coffee break after that, before we head on to the second conversation of the day, entitled Words, 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 How Conspiracy Theories and Polarized Talk Show Rhetorics and Social Media Activities Distort Our Perception of Reality. It's going to be a panel where we are going to see the head of the German TV channel WDR, Sonja Mikisch, encountering Lukasz Wojciecha, a Polish journalist and author whom you might have discovered already yesterday, because he's a very active Twitterer and has commented extensively on our first panels. And I think it's going to be a very interesting conversation and a very controversial conversation, which is going to be moderated by Beppe Severnini, a very distinguished journalist and author from Italy, who's won the title of European Journalist of the Year and who's also written a very charming cultural theory about what it means to be Italian, which you can also find in the bookstands outside. After our working lunch, our last panel for today includes the flamboyant philosopher and cultural critic Slavoj Žižek from Slovenia, who will encounter the writer Elif Shafak. The panel is going to be moderated by the Czech journalist Martin Ale, and the topic is an approach towards productive methods and narratives to face extremism and the disintegration of Europe. The students are still working on a manifesto that has already been drafted, which you might actually be able to find on the Goethe-Institut's webpage. And that draft is going to be perfectionized and edited until tonight. And then it's going to be presented in our last panel at 4 o'clock, together with the Member of European Parliament, Joe Linen. And there's going to be a question and answer session on the manifesto and on the question, what are we gonna do with this? And to paraphrase our previous speaker, how are we going to get out of this? It's my great pleasure to introduce now our first panel for today and the 10 students from the second group who are going to participate in the panel. Please welcome Paul Scheffer, Firas Alshater, who should be there via Skype, and Isolde Charim, the moderator of the first panel.
Ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you to our morning session on the topic scapegoating, why racism could gain so much ground and how it feels to be a migrant in contemporary Europe. Let me first introduce our guests. Right next to me on my left side, Paul Scheffer. Paul Scheffer is professor for European Studies at the University of Tilburg in the Netherlands. In 2000, he published an article called The Multicultural Disaster. Drama. Oh, The Multicultural. Okay. That's okay. Sorry. But what is correct, that this article has shocked the liberal society in the Netherlands. I think that's correct. Announcing the conflicts of a pluralized society. Later on, he published a book, Immigrant Nations, a book that was republished this year in the 10th edition. Correct? 16, okay, a book on how immigration is changing our world. On my right side, right next to me, you see nobody. This should have been the place of Firas Alshater. Firas Alshater is a Syrian actor, author, and filmmaker. He was persecuted by the Assad regime, 4 times arrested. He was jailed and tortured for 9 months. He succeeded in leaving Syria, and since 2013, he lives in Berlin. He has started a YouTube channel called Zukar, which means sugar, and became, a quote, Germany's first refugee YouTuber, with more than 2 million clicks. The Times nominated him as one of the next generation leaders. But, as you can see, Firas Alshater's place is empty. The point was that his permit of residence expired, and as he wanted to apply for a prolongation, it turned out that the German officials have lost his passport. This is really a strange bureaucracy. Now, Firas Alshater is illegal in Germany and couldn't leave the country to join us here in Brussels. What we now have is a panel discussion with Firas on Skype, hopefully. This setting, a panel on migration and refugees, and the refugee can't take part because he has no papers. A sans-papier who can't cross borders, this setting is like a mise-en-scène of our topic. But unfortunately, this is neither an art intervention nor a demonstration for showing the situation of migrants. In fact, it is the reality Firas Alshater and along with him all the refugees are living in. So let's come back to our topic. Why racism could gain so much ground and how it feels to be a migrant in contemporary Europe. That is to say, we have 2 questions. Why and how? And we have 2 panelists, a theorist and a person personally concerned. It seems to be obvious to ask the theorist for an analysis, to ask him why, and the concerned for an account for the how. But I would like to ask both questions to both guests. I have no idea what happens to the Skype. Is there a Skype connection? What?
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Hi.
Hi, okay.
Can you see me?
Hello!
Hi.
Welcome! That's great.
I was talking to you all the time. I was seeing you. So it's fine.
Okay. Okay, but I'm very happy to see that we can see and hear you. My first question goes to Paul Scheffer. Paul, what do you think how a migrant feels in contemporary Europe?
That's, of course, a good question to ask me, living in Amsterdam for almost 50 years. But I've been speaking and engaged with migrant communities over the last 20 years. I wouldn't think of myself as only an academic. I've been involved in all these questions for a long time as a concerned citizen. first of all. So when you ask me how migrants feel, I come across Kadisha Arik, who's president of our parliament, first generation Moroccan migrant, doing very well, having a great impact in Dutch society. I come across young people in some neighborhoods in Amsterdam, unemployed, without any idea how they're going to find a way in our society, and who hold deeply anti-Semitic views. That's reality. So there's a lot of diversity within diversity. I come across people in Berlin, you know, fantastic Turkish writer, Turkish background, who publishes great novels, enriches German literature. And I come across families who have been alienated from society and live basically the life they were living in a village somewhere in the Turkish countryside and trying to reproduce that isolated life in the midst of Berlin. I come across many different people. I would say migrants are human beings.
Firas, how do you feel being a refugee in Berlin?
Cold.
Cold?
Well, it's like, you know, to be a refugee, nobody of us decide to be a refugee in any country. It just happened that we have to be a refugee. That's something that we didn't plan it. I mean, I never said for my mother, I hope to be in future a refugee in Germany or in Berlin. That was not my dream work to be here. And in one time I have to leave my country and to be here to start from zero, learning language, to find the people, to find the connection, to build my life. So that's not kind of easy things. And the most hard things, it's like when you have to forget everything you built it for your life and you start from zero with searching friends to find where you exactly you are. It's not about that just the country, it's about the feeling if you will feel home here or not. This is, you can't do it alone. You need to help from the people who are from here. You need to have a connection with these people. And like to have a German friend, you have to learn German language. And to learn German language, you have to have a German friend. So it's like somehow complicated. And it's just need time. It just need like I want to do something, so I have to take my time to do it. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. So like it just we are everyone. He needs just time to do what he planning or to do what he want to do in the country where he didn't plan to come in.
Okay, let's come to the second topic, to fear, the feeling of fear, the European angst in the title, which is not the German angst anymore, but the European one. How do you feel about this fear, Paul?
How do I feel? Well, I try to think about it.
Okay.
And then I would say it's a deeply mistaken way of trying to understand what is going on in our societies. It's a way to belittle people, to say that they're in the grip of irrational emotions, destructive emotions, and not first of all trying to understand, to listen to ideas, to political movements with whom you might deeply disagree, but first trying to understand what are the interests, the ideas that are being articulated. So, for example, the whole debate about Islam in Western Europe. I would say it's not a question of fear, it's a question of a problem of adaptation on both sides. So it reminds me very much of America in the 19th century, Protestant America, a lot of Catholic migrants arriving from Italy, Poland, Ireland. And American society had to rethink what it was, including those Catholic migrants, you know, not only having an exclusive Protestant idea of itself, and these Catholic migrants had to learn how to live as a religious minority coming from societies that were almost exclusively Catholic. So this was a process of adaptation on both sides, a lot of conflict, a long history of 80 years of conflict and mutual adaptation. So when I come to think of Islam, first of all, the Netherlands, France, has to come up with an idea. Do we have an idea of our society inclusive of these Muslim communities? But within those Muslim communities, the question should be asked, how are you going to live here? Are you going to live here with the idea you claim rights without feeling any obligation towards the society? I come across too many people when I'm invited in a mosque who say, we claim the right of religious freedom, and say, well, of course you should do, but then you should accept the responsibility to defend the same freedom for people with other religions or no religion, and that is a deep problem. So there is a tendency, there is a lot of prejudice also within the Muslim communities. There's a lot of anti-Semitism. You know, research shows that half of Muslim youth in six West European countries say Jews can never be trusted. So those problems we have to talk about. Nothing to do with fear, has to do with cultural conflict, with religious conflict, with conflict between traditions that people bring with them. And people who are socialized in deeply illiberal societies don't become liberal overnight when coming to Europe. So I would say, let's forget the fear. Let's start by understanding that cultural, religious conflict has always been part of the story of migration. And then we can come up with answers.
But let me just add another question. If you are talking like this, you say there are real problems and there is a kind of real fear, but we have to deal...
No, I wouldn't use the word fear.
Okay, you wouldn't use the word fear. You have real problems and we have to solve the problems. But what we have experienced in the last year is that we have a kind of coding, a code conversion from refugee to threat. That's what we experience very much. And that means we don't have to deal only on this real level, on the level of real problems, yeah, but it's also an imaginary one.
Yeah, but that there is perhaps a political disagreement, because I don't think that it's a figment of the imagination when Germany loses control over its borders, when in 1 year, 1 million people arrive, and many who are not registered, no idea who is coming. Of course there is a sense of that the rule of law depends on a sense of control of borders. Borders are not walls. Walls are meant to prevent the flow of people. Borders are meant to regulate the flow of people, to have an idea as a society or in a European level to answer the question, who do we think we can protect here, we can receive, and whom is not allowed to come? I mean, if you lose any sense of control or grip on that question, people become, there you have the sense of conflict in a society. So I think we have to find the moral middle ground between open borders, the deep illusion of Angela Merkel, which you could only do for 1 year, and after that 1 year, I've been in Germany many times, nobody said, what we have done in 2015, we're going to do in 2016 or 2017. I think the problem of refugees will be with us for a long, long time. So we need to come up with answers that are long-term, not make a big gesture for 1 year and then not being able to come up with any solutions anymore. So we have to recreate a moral middle ground between the idea of open borders, which is not sustainable, and the illusion of closed borders, which is not sustainable either. So I think it's a rational discussion about what European societies can come up with in terms of integration, in terms of giving people shelter, etc. So we have to find a balance between the needs of those outside of our borders. We cannot turn our backs to that, but Europe lives, you know, confronted with a zone of countries that are in deep trouble. And at the same time, we have to answer to the needs of people within our borders. So we have to find a new balance that cannot be solved either by the big idea of open borders, which is an illusion and is going to create majorities which will say, close the border. And we have to be very much more precise in our criticism of the tendencies to close borders. So to recreate a moral middle ground. But there you shouldn't start with the ideas of fear and scapegoating and racism, but try to understand what the reactions have been.
Firas, could you follow what Paul Scheffer said?
Yeah.
And what is your meaning? Are you more on the side of the fear or more of the side of the rational discourse?
Well, for me, I can tell you, like, xenophobia is okay. We have to stop really criticizing people because of their fears. I can understand xenophobia, the fear of the foreigner, like arachnophobia, when people are afraid from spiders. Anyone of you like spiders? Yes? No? Nobody likes spiders, I think. It's okay. It's totally okay to fear spiders. We would never tell somebody shame of you because you are afraid from spiders, even if spiders are a useful animals, you know? Or someone who suffers from paranoia. If somebody have a paranoia, fear of feeling that somebody follow me, it's okay to serve that, to have that. But like this way, I mean paranoia or fear of spiders, fear of strangers, it's totally okay. If I say it's okay, it means we have to accept it as a fact. But there is a people who told us, poor people, yes, your fear is justified. Those people are the populists, and they use the fear of others' people. And these people, who we have to do something against them. The populists, that they use the fear of others' people, and those people who are the dangers for Europe right now, I feel that. Like, it's exactly, there was always people like that in Europe, but now they use the fear of the people who, the poor people who are afraid from the refugee or from the migrant people and whatever. So we have to find a solution for against those people who are using the fear of other people.
Yeah, but how are you going to find the solution? Yeah. When you start by saying that people are in the grip of deeply irrational motives, how can you, that's a form of fatalism. Because if people are, a majority of our societies would be really in the grip of irrational, destructive motives, only of fear of others, generally speaking. How can you ever come up with a solution?
Yeah, the problem is like since years till now, all the people talking about the refugee, about the migrant and whatever, but they don't talk with. And I will be afraid from somebody if I don't know. We have to make the door open to people, let it know each other, to talk with others and to have more connection with each other. This is a big problem here, even for the refugee here, to have in contact, to feel home here, to get to feel that they home and to feel they are welcome here. They have to get contact with people, and the big problem of a lot of people because they don't know each other, and this is a problem that we have to work for it. You know, yeah. Like to build something to make people know each other, to talk with each other, and to have more connection with each other. I know there is like people who are using the fear of other people, and what we have to do now, it's like to tell them that's this fear, it's okay if you are afraid, but try to get the contact with people to know if your fear gonna be big or it's nothing.
But I think it has not much to do with fear. It has to do, first of all, with the reality. In a country like the Netherlands, we have received 750,000 refugees in the last 40 years. So Dutch society, we're now city of Amsterdam, half of the population are migrant families, same for Rotterdam, etc. So this society has been quite open to migration and refugees. So there are two main problems. First, that only one third of the refugees who have been received in the Netherlands, you know, who have been living in the Netherlands for 20 years or more, only one third is working, and work is defined as 8 hours a week or more. So I guess that about one in five of the refugees who've been coming to the Netherlands have found work. There's not a question of guilt. There's been mistakes, problems on all sides, but that is a reality. So first of all, the question is, how many people can you in a meaningful way protect in your society and give access, and that they find access to the labor market? Second problem is that people coming from deeply illiberal societies are not becoming liberals overnight. So there are deep conflicts of values, about family values, about relation between men and women, attitudes towards homosexuality, attitudes towards other religious minorities, which are deeply troubling. So there is a real conflict there. It's not a figment of the imagination. It's not a fear that is born out of thin air. It's a real conflict of values, traditions, and that is also not a question of guilt, but something we have to try to understand and work on. But this is has been the story of migration for almost 150 years. Look at the story in the United States. Look at earlier migrations of Italians in France, etc. So we have to understand that that the history of migration is a history full of conflict, socio-economic conflict, cultural conflict, and if we start to work from there, then we understand something. We not project our own misunderstandings on others, saying you are fearful, because it's never about us. When I started to write about migration, I started trying to understand, living in Amsterdam, seeing how my neighborhood was changing, to understand why my own tolerance was eroding. Not the tolerance of others, my own tolerance. Because I saw things, for example, in the mosque, in the local mosques, things were said that were deeply troubling. We have to start there. That is not about fear, but about real conflict.
But I have two objections. First of all, the conflict is not between the migrants and the people who lived there before, but the conflict, and I'm coming from Austria, and I think we know now what the conflict can be. The conflict is, right, it crosses the society. You have on one side the people who are pluralists, and other side you have people against this. This is a kind of conflict. You don't have only conflict between the newcomers and the people who were there before.
Sure, there is a deep conflict within the Muslim community. I mean, the chapter in my book about migration, about Islam, is, the title is The Divided House of Islam. So I know very well that within the Muslim communities you have deep conflict, within the majority population, if you want to describe it as well, there's deep conflict. Of course, there's conflict on all sides. But I think those conflicts should be understood as real conflicts of values, as social economic conflicts, about inequality. Most of the time, migration makes societies more unequal. Look at the history of the United States. It's no coincidence that immigrant societies on the whole have less welfare state, less social protection. You can talk about the merits of that, you can talk about the problems, but when we don't start there, I think we lose what is really, in my view, the big blind spot of liberalism, is that 97% of the world population are not migrants. Most of the people are not that mobile. We have to understand that our societies are more defined by immobility than by mobility. And for example, 7 out of 10 people in France live in the region where they were born. So if we don't understand that basic reality, very simple, actually. If I come, every university has its department of research into migration mobility. There is not one research unit trying to understand the value and the meaning of immobility. So we have a big blind spot for a reality how most people live their lives. They're not that mobile. And that is the breeding ground of populism. I would do everything to combat populism. But first we have to understand the sociological realities, or put it more simple, the social realities behind it. And then we can work on it. But if we forget about the fact that most people are not that mobile, are not world citizens, don't have a very cosmopolitan view of the world, then we miss out perhaps the majority of our citizens. And that in a democracy is really problematic.
Firas, what do you think about the conflicts between migrants, Germans, where you're living within the German society?
Well, I mean, like when any refugees start to come here to this country, they start to and first of all to tell them like, hey, you have to integrate yourself and to start to find work or to start to find to learn the language and. But I ask myself like always, how you could ask somebody to do all of that if you don't help him there too? Like if you left the refugee living in somehow in far away of the next village, like 10 kilometers, the next supermarket will be 10 kilometers. I have to wait 2 hours for the next bus to catch, to go to the supermarket to buy anything. How I could integrate myself in this country, how I could learn the language, how I could build myself here, how I could find a job later, how I could do something for me, for myself, and for this country if the people don't help me, don't give me the place. How I could find life here if I have to do like to search 2 years to find just my own home to leave the refugees camp or to leave the room where I live with my refugees friend, you know? Like all of that needs also like help from people who are from this country. It needs doors to open it for them, you know, like, and about the people who are thinking about the problem between the refugees and the Germans or whatever. Well, to be honest, like that was always this problems here or what's going on. It's like about if something's happened in Köln, so in Colonia, so they say all the refugees, they have to defy the same and say sorry because we didn't do that, we did that. It's not about like if someone did something stupid, that's not mean all the refugees have to say sorry about that.
No, but it's not a question of, because the invitation when you're critical of German society, and I think there's lots to criticize about our societies, lots to improve about Dutch society, French society, German society. But what I saw is that there is a great capacity of empathy, because I've seen most of the time, wherever I go in Europe, there are more volunteers than there are refugees. There's a lot of civic engagement. And of course, what is needed, not only a self-critical attitude in receiving societies, but also forms of self-criticism in migrant communities, because there's also a lot to improve about attitudes in some migrant communities. There's a lot of prejudice there as well. If I look at, you know, for example, the Moroccan community or the Turkish community, let's start with the Turkish community. In the Netherlands, we have seen deep conflict there between the supporters of the Gulen movement and the supporters of Erdogan, violence, a lot of attacks vis-a-vis each other. So, you know, I think for me, and that is a big enrichment of migration for a society, it is an invitation to self-investigation, self-critical attitudes on all sides. There is nothing irrational about that. That's an invitation to improve, to measure ourselves against ideals of equal treatment, freedom of speech, freedom of religion. That's easy to say, it's very difficult to practice, but that will be the starting point for me. An invitation to self-criticism on all sides, to be open-minded, and to measure ourselves against ideals which we could share, perhaps.
This sounds very good, Paul, but the big but is it's very far from the reality we are living now.
Because people are saying on the one hand, you have those who defend migrant communities, others the populists who defend native populations, and we have, of course, to rise above that partisan attitude. We have to find a common ground, a common idea of citizenship, and not as an abstraction, but as a lived reality. And I do, of course, agree that, you know, if we would have more civic engagement even more, and we would find each other in the neighborhoods where we live, in schools, in the places where we work. Yes, but there's forms of segregation that are parts of every story of migration, actually. So it's a long-term engagement, but I think it can only be successful, and that is, of course, the lesson of classical immigration nations. Obama was not suggesting we have to open the borders. So public acceptance of migration and of people, of refugees, is built on the condition that people have the impression, and of course that can never be 100%, of course not, no North Korean border controls, of course not, but that people have the impression it's part of a world future. The big problem we have with migration is that people perceive it now as a world out of control, that's something that comes over us. That's not something we can consciously shape with public acceptance, but something that, you know, the argument that people give, if people are not accepted as legal migrants, they will come illegally. It doesn't have any meaning, borders, in the 21st century. Well, if you continue along that way, you will find yourself in societies with majorities who say, close the border. Populism is about one thing. It's about taking back control, like the Brexit, yeah. Trump building a wall. How are we going to prevent that? Not by saying borders are illusions anymore. No, by trying to have an idea about migration, about refugees, trying to recreate what I see is the moral middle ground. And that is not an idea of completely open borders. That is simply not sustainable. It's only going to provoke majorities who will be then, if the liberals have no idea about what borders are, symbolically, materially, then the illiberal attitudes will gain in our society. I'm deeply convinced about it, and that is what we see happening every day.
So one more question to both of us. What we experienced was 1.5 years ago, we have this huge welcome culture in Germany and Austria and other countries. Now this, and what you said, there are so many people engaged, but what we experience afterward is that this welcome culture has been discredited. Now it also turned. Now it is a kind of bad word. It became, so what do you think, why did it change, Firas?
Well, I don't feel that it changed, you know, but the problem in our world now, if you have 100 dogs and one of these dogs breaking, so this dog will get directly an interview and all the media will talk about him. And if someone who will be nice for others, nobody will talk about him. This is a problem in our world at this time. You know, like, not all the people talking about what others people doing. I feel always welcome here, and I still feeling that the welcome culture is still strong here in Germany, but the media always focusing about other things. They focusing about what make people make more clicks, or buy to see what's going on, or to be afraid, you know? So, like, they use, actually, most of the people using statistically or and fact. Yeah, I mean, imagine you say good night for your little daughter before she sleep, and she's afraid from her, the monster below her bed. And you tell her, my darling, statistically, one of every 100 kids will be killed from this monster. This will be not help, you know? This will be doing nothing. Statistically, the most dangerous people around us are the people who we know. And the most murder happens by people who we know and our friends. It's just, you know, like the culture here, I feel it's still the welcome culture here strong. But most of the people focusing about the stupid people who do something bad in these countries now.
Okay, now I would like the students here to start with their question, please.
Hello, my name is Judith and I'm from Hungary. So you mentioned that 97% of European people are immobile.
World population.
Oh, world population, sorry, are immobile. So I think there is a huge gap between the younger generation and the older generation in this. And in our perception of migration and refugees. And I think that's thanks to all the European Union initiatives to mobilize people, to give us the opportunity to study abroad, to open up to the world. If you just talk to us, like half of us will say, oh, I'm originally from here, but now I live here. So do you think there is the need to mobilize the older generations as well? And if yes, how would you achieve this?
Yeah, first of all, let's contradict what you were saying, because it's simply not true. If you look at France, for example, the Front National, the populist party in France, has its biggest following in the age group between 18 and 24. So it's not true. Also for the Netherlands, the populist party, if there are elections in schools, secondary high schools, our populist party is the biggest party within the category of young people. So it's simply not an accurate way of looking at the world. It's talking from my own experience. If I look at my students at the university, sure. But there are other people as well who are not students. There's a lot of people with lower education who are far less mobile, who are not invited by Erasmus programs to study
in
Barcelona.
For example,
yeah, but you're talking about perhaps 15% of young people who are traveling in the world. And then, even then, if you look at those young people, you know, studying for half a year abroad, I've studied for 2 years in Paris when I was 23. I lived as a correspondent in Warsaw, so I've seen a little bit, I've moved around as well, but I came back to the Netherlands. So I think most people, even if they study for some time abroad, if you look at the real choices they make in their life, how many people are really continuing to live outside of the country where they were born? In the Netherlands, it's actually not that big group. Most people are living in the Netherlands who were born there. So the mobility of people, also of the younger generation, over long term, with whom are you going to marry? To whom do you feel a deep sense of obligation? In what language can you, in a meaningful way, disagree with somebody? So I think even for the younger generation, if we look generally at it, more precise at it, this whole idea of we're all very mobile and we are born in a multicultural society. If I look at the schools in Amsterdam, there's a segregation in the school. And if I go at lunchtime in those schools, I can see Moroccan pupils sitting together, Surinamese pupils sitting together, etc., etc. So the young are not that open-minded as they think of themselves. It's a far more complicated picture. So yes, we have to mobilize also the older generations. But in France, for example, the older generation between 50 and 65 is the group where the Front National has the least votes, the least, much less than in the younger generation. So I think for Hungary, by the way, I would think that there is also really a populist movement also among part of the younger generation who are following Orban. So let's be, or in Poland as well. So let's be a little bit self-critical and look beyond this simple idea of generations.
Is this working? Okay. Hello. Thank you very much for your contribution. My name is Invanela, and I come from Albania. Well, I would like to get back again to the main topic on why racism could gain so much ground and how it feels to be a migrant in a contemporary Europe. Well, actually, to me, it seems like, well, it is unfortunately the European Union struggle with this unprecedented influx of refugees still remained like the decisive issue for the 2016, and probably it will remain so also for the upcoming year. And I know that Europe was facing like economic crisis and also the social classes, clash of classes. Like of the elite and those of the rural areas and people feeling less represented. And by this time, when you have also such influx of refugees, it's very easy to blame these people for all these instabilities that are being created. So that's how it can gain so much ground by this sense. But going back again to how it feels to be a migrant in contemporary Europe, I think we are missing a very important point in here. As at the beginning of the Skype interview, we mentioned that nobody chooses to be a refugee. And here, we are not distinguishing what is a migrant and what is a refugee, which is a very important aspect, because also we have this definition also in the United Nations Convention of Refugees adopted in 1951 and also a protocol in 1967, which both are really relevant. So in this regard, I think that our society, like European society, shouldn't it reflect a little bit? So this is like the main question. Shouldn't it reflect a little bit to start to find the mistakes on our own, to ourselves, rather than to blame these refugees who come from a very desperate conditions, and apart from that, they do not choose to leave their country. So they are living from a war. Actually, they are not terrorists, but they are rather fleeing from such an environment. And I think we should start by accepting this thing. So reflecting in our societies for this condition. So
maybe Firas, could you answer?
War. Well, okay, I could answer, but can you please make it shortly a question then? Because that was very long for me.
Well, mostly this could be like a question for the European citizens, since they are like constantly putting the blame on the refugees. But probably you, as a refugee or asylum seeker in Berlin, could make a comment on how the European society should like stop blaming you for some social problems that they do have.
Well, this is a problem, you know, like in Germany, if any Muslims or any refugees, that's something bad. We have all the refugees have to say sorry and go on the street having roses and give to people and say we are sorry. But why in German people, some, for example, don't say sorry? Because there is some stupid German attacked the refugees camp, the refugees' home. I don't ask them to tell me sorry because I know who did that. They are already stupid people. And I don't have to say sorry if also like a terrorist or a stupid man did something stupid in this country. Like we are refugee, we left our country as a community, like as a big people. There is a good people of this, and there is a bad people, of course. So we have to know that's like a big community. There is a lot of them. There is like people who already did something bad in my country. But I have no idea who they are. And I am responsible about what I do. I don't want to always say I'm sorry because this guy, he did something bad, and not all the Syrians are like that. Just he's like that. This is like, I feel always like I have to always say, I'm sorry, but I don't have to do that. I didn't do that anything to say sorry for all the problem what will come also.
But I would say, you know, it's interesting to listen to your question. You would immediately disagree with generalizations about refugee communities or migrant communities, yet you speak about European societies blaming refugees in a very generalizing way. So shouldn't we be more differentiating about those societies and differentiate about refugees, etc.? So I do agree. We don't have to say sorry to each other all the time. It's not a question of who is to blame, but it's a sense of responsibility. As a citizen of the Netherlands, I feel responsible when populism is gaining force. I feel responsible when people have prejudices against migrants. I feel responsible when there is a threat of violence in the streets of the city where I live. I feel deeply responsible for the acts where I don't feel any sense of guilt. Guilt is individual, but the sense of responsibility can be collective. And I would invite migrant communities, but also those coming as refugees to the Netherlands or Germany, etc., when there are acts or ideas, it's not about acts so much, but it's very much about ideas, traditions, attitudes towards others, towards religious minorities, towards homosexuals, etc., to be also having a sense of responsibility discussing it, confronting attitudes that are deeply illiberal, I think that's a sense of responsibility on both sides that helps us further. It's not a question of saying sorry or feeling guilty. It's a question of saying we are here as citizens, we're going to stay here, we're part of this society, and we do feel a deep sense of responsibility, not only for our own fate, but for the fate of those others. We're part of a larger entity, and I think that it would be so much more productive than questions of blame and guilt, because in the end, you know, it doesn't help us any further. Sense of responsibility does help us further.
Media. So it happens very often that media does not portray the reality in a correct way or uses inflammatory or discriminatory language towards the migrants, what causes the deterioration of the situation. So I remember one example of Charlie Hebdo. So the terrorist attack happened there, but why did it happen? It can be said that it was a result of a very disrespectful cartoon about Prophet Muhammad. So on the one hand, it caused the increase of resentment in migrants, and on the other hand, it resulted in an increase in Islamophobia in European societies. So such actions make the gap between these two sides even more. So that's why I absolutely agree with the opinion that without respecting and understanding the values, religions, and cultures of each other, it's absolutely impossible to achieve anything. So whatever is my question is that, how should be media regulated or controlled somehow in a way that it does not violate the basic principle of democracy, such as freedom of expression?
Whoa.
Whoa, I cannot disagree with you more. Religious freedom and criticism of religion, making ridicule out of religion, are completely not to be separated. You cannot have religious freedom without the freedom to criticize or ridicule a religion. There is no such thing as a human right to be respected in the sense that you cannot, that you have to be shielded from criticism or that people make fun of your beliefs. That's part of an open society. So yes, I would criticize those who would only make caricatures of Muhammad and who wouldn't defend the freedom of Muslims. But I would also be critical of those who claim a right to be respected without giving respect to others with whom they deeply disagree. So that sense of reciprocity is needed, and we don't need much regulation of media, for God's sake. Don't regulate the media too much, but believe in the fact that an open society with freedom of speech are on the whole more peaceful societies, because struggling with words and with images translate anger into words that can be confronted. But without those words, without that freedom of expression, the anger spills over into aggression immediately. So societies where the freedom of speech is curbed are societies that are less peaceful. So we have a lot to lose when we would curtail the freedom of religion, when we would curtail the freedom... Oh, our friend has disappeared into thin air. But really, I would really defend the right to make caricatures about Jesus, about the Prophet Muhammad, about anybody. We cannot shield ourselves from the ideas and also the fun, the misunderstanding, the mischievous ideas of others. We shouldn't.
In the sense of the freedom of speech, In the sense of freedom of speech, I would like to open the floor now for your questions from the public, please. But I can't see, over there, the first. Do we have a microphone? Yeah. There is, okay, yes. Yeah, somebody should bring you a microphone. Christina? Okay, somebody bring it. Please, the microphone there, over there.
Thank you. I would like to ask some questions about our predatory economic system that makes few people much, much richer and a lot of others poorer, middle class, people who have generations of poverty. I would like to touch on those issues also, not just refugees who come one culture, another culture, but problems that we have in our society, regardless of refugees. For example, also our planet that is in bad shape. The wars, who has responsibility in those wars? Can we talk about those issues? Because now I find the discussion very, very narrow. Thank you.
Okay, would you like to answer, or should we collect?
Oh,
I think this was kind of an answer.
No, I can.
Okay, so.
I don't want to take too much time by answering, but because our friend in Berlin is somehow... Yeah, you're there. You're back.
Firas, have you heard the question from the public?
No, unfortunately, I didn't hear it. Hello.
Hello, I think you should answer because it's...
Okay, I'm sorry, I'm going to answer it, but I don't want to take all of your time.
No problem.
But so I mean, equal treatment here is important as well. But okay, of course, talking about, first of all, the question of inequality in our own societies is definitely one of the great questions. And I think it's in a very direct sense linked to globalization, which makes, and that is for me the great hopeful story of our times, the equality between nations, it strengthens it. So I'm doing research on China and India and Brazil and how it affects Europe, the rise of those countries. But it's the big story of our time is, of course, how many millions have been fleeing and been made possible that they escape poverty. 300 million people in China, tens of millions in Brazil, in India. So that's a great story of our times. But the inequality in our societies has been growing. And of course, the reaction to globalization when Angela Merkel and others say there's no alternative. Of course, there is a critical discourse on globalization. It's absolutely possible. There's now, for the first time, a real debate on the merits, but also the problems of free trade and how it affects societies. So that is the discussion we need, not to look at globalization as if it was a sort of event of nature, but something that is man-made. Some regulations are necessary, others aren't, so we have to talk about that. Then the wars that surround us. I think that is, for me, the great question of our time. If I look at Europe, Ukraine, what's going on in Turkey now? What is going on in the Middle East? What is going on in Northern Africa? I only talk about the zone of insecurity, conflict, war, civil war that surrounds Europe. I would focus with all the energy I have on Egypt. I think that will be, in the next 5 years to 10 years, that will be the big story of our times. Because climate change, a military dictatorship there, deep religious divides in that society, corrupt political elite, all those factors taken together with a population of now over 90 million people, of which half are 24 years old or younger. Where are all those young people going? What is their future? They're better educated than ever, and their future is less certain than ever. Where are they going? How is the implosion of Egypt that is going on? How will it affect people? How is climate change going to affect the livelihood of people in Egypt? So if we look at those realities that surround us, then we cannot escape the moral dilemma in our societies to what extent can we open ourselves to the needs of those outside of our borders, and how do we see the relation of those needs with the needs of people inside of our borders? That is the big moral dilemma we are facing, and then we cannot say, you know, globalization is the condition of the world we live in, point. No, we have to reflect seriously on it. Either, if we don't do that, then we're going to see majorities in our societies that are going to be more and more drifting toward illiberal ideas about closure of borders, not wanting to accept any responsibility for the needs of those outside of our borders. And I think, you know, the massive realities of war and conflict in our neighborhood, that raises so much questions. And if we don't discuss it, I think we are, in a sense, contributing to the alienation of part of our population that doesn't feel very much privileged. You know, there's part of our population that don't live lives that are fantastic. Of course, compared to the condition of many people elsewhere in Africa, yes, but given their chances of finding employment, finding a better education, living in better housing conditions, there are many problems in our own societies.
More questions? Yeah. Oh, okay, the first public and then. Yeah.
I would like to add an important feeling, and it is that in three generations, the people who today have a pressure on the press, on the Brexit, who are responsible, who vote for populist people. I think that it's time that responsible people understand that in three generations, maximum four, the population of our world went from sending a message with a dove and loading their smartphone in a wireless way. And I think that a big part of the population has lost the feeling of how fast the world went. And I think many people, millions of people, feel today very lost. People tell them, yes, you're part of this modern world and so on, and we can go to university and so on, but I think there are millions who did not go in that way. And I think it's time that people understand that they are the ones who are voting in a different way today.
Yes, your question. No, first, okay. Could you please answer the question? Would you like to answer?
I would simply say that I do agree with this way of looking. I mean, the way informatization or robotization is going to affect part of the labor force, only that question, only, that's one of the big, big questions of the coming decades. How is it going to affect the chances of many people finding a meaningful job? So those questions, you know, the rapid transformation of our world. But I think still, you know, the diagnosis, I've seen so much studies suggesting that we live the end of geography. That geography, you know, distance doesn't play a role anymore in the virtual world. Yes, in the virtual world, perhaps. But if you look at the use of Facebook, more than 90% of the use of Facebook is within the same language. If you look at telephone, which is also very mobile, a country like the Netherlands, the use of the mobile telephone within our borders is 6,500 times more intense than the use of mobile telephones for communication across borders. So the depth of globalization, we should talk about it. How deep is it going, really? Whom does it affect? Whom doesn't it affect too much? And then I suggest to you look at the Global Connectedness Index, fantastic study done every 2 years by the post company in Germany, DHL. They assemble a great team of researchers studying how deep globalization is really affecting our societies. And then you come up with a reality that there is a part of the population, and a much larger part than we think, that is not very mobile, that is not you know, living lives that are completely connected with the wider world.
Now I have a question here. Oh, so many. Okay, and then, okay, so let's collect questions. I think otherwise we will be, oh, first you.
Hi. So I think when we are speaking about hate speech, and nowadays we also need to speak about radicalization. Because on one end we have far-right extremist radicalization, but on the other end we also have an increase of Islamic extremist, Islamic radicalization, namely the Islamic State, Daesh. And I think obviously their sociological motivation are different. However, their goal, it's the same. I believe their goal is to deny some moral values that are the basis of our human rights foundation. For example, they want to deny freedom of speech, equality, or even tolerance. And I also believe that we, as young people, we need to challenge hate speech, we need to challenge radicalization, and we even need to defend global human rights. However, I think this isn't enough. And my question is, how can we prevent and how can we counter radicalization?
Should we collect a few? Firas, okay, how can we prevent radicalization?
Wow.
A short receipt.
A short receipt? Yeah. I have no idea.
By growing a serious beard, no?
You know, like I have seen a lot in the last time. You know, like all that what we try to do with hating or against radicals, it's gonna not work. Since I start to make funny videos and start to make to use humor against all the stuff. Since I start to use that, I recognize with humor we could reach more people than we think. So we have to make maybe people, bring people to love, and then we start to love.
Yeah, I think humor is definitely the best way to counter radicalization. But, for example, if I look at those who are going to Syria, I think there is, you know, the what I think is not supportable anymore is the Western involvement in the Middle East, where you say to people in the Netherlands, in Germany, in France, you know, the separation of state and church is so important for religious freedom. And then our biggest ally in the Middle East is Saudi Arabia, a theocracy. We talk about human rights and we support a military coup in Egypt. So I understand those who say we measure with two different sets of norms, norms we apply internally in our own societies and the norms we don't have in our foreign policy. So yes, there is a lot to criticize there, and I understand at least when we talk about radicalization, for example, within Muslim communities, I understand partly where it comes from. But I wouldn't make a conflation of radical views, generally speaking, you know, and those who commit acts of violence. Because radicalization has always been there. I mean, I'm a child of the 60s, and my God, in the 60s, there were very much radical views of the world, you know, people thinking that Mao Zedong was a great hero, etc., and that Fidel Castro was the answer to all our problems. So there were radical views around. I would like to live in a society where there is radical views around, people questioning the status quo. But where, of course, the problem is when it spills over into acts of violence. And we have seen the Brigata Rossi, we have seen acts of terrorism with a left-wing orientation throughout Europe, you know, the Rote Armee Fraktion. Now we are facing threats of violence with different inspiration. And that is, of course, deeply troubling. But I would always think that freedom of speech, including radical views from all sides, is the best antidote against aggression, against violence.
There was one more question. So please, let's collect the two questions, but be rather short.
So I will try and be as quick as possible. Thank you so much for your contribution so far. It's been very interesting. I'm from England, but I study at the University of Warsaw and the University of Maastricht. So I feel that I've had a lot of luck in learning about different opinions and how people feel specifically about the refugee crisis and about migration. Now, my question is, as a British person, we ignored the opinions of many people and how they felt about the EU. We have an extreme problem that we ignored all the secret Brexiteers, as we call them, and exactly the same thing has happened in the US. So my question is, how can we listen to a liberal or extreme opinions without legitimizing them, or the motions behind them? And my idea would be to be able to conduct covert research, to go into places and actually find out how people feel about things, but rather than actually asking them to come to academic institutions, actually understanding how they feel about things rather than statements that they would make. But then again, is that against what we stand for in the idea of transparency and trying to be as transparent as possible? Would that be a possible solution for it?
Yeah, but saying, you know, you need covert research almost betrays a sense of alienation towards the society you live in. It's not that complicated, you know. I make 80 speeches a year. I go into many different places in the Netherlands. You know, there's irrationality and post-factual ideas on all sides. But I would always start by listening, taking people seriously, not treating them as children who don't know what they're saying, not saying, you know, you're in the grip of xenophobic ideas, but simply listening to people who are saying, my neighborhood, where I lived for generations, has changed enormously. Now my neighbors come from Somalia, the man across the street is perhaps from Turkey, the other one is next door is from Pakistan, and I don't feel at home anymore in the place where I used to live. It's quite often that simple, and I think what I try to do in my research is to postpone words like racism, xenophobia, it's all there, it does exist, but to postpone them as long as possible and to look at the simple realities of the difficulty of living together. You know, trying to understand how residents who have been living for a long time in a neighborhood and newcomers, you know, how they have to find their way. Looking at simple, basic facts that are, from a human perspective, very well understandable on all sides, also on the sides of migrants that are coping with a sense of loss, you know, losing a known world, trying to find your way in a new society is never easy, never. Why don't we listen to those voices without making an overstatement immediately of saying, you know, in Germany they talk about Integrationsverweigerer, people who refuse to integrate. No, it's a simple human reality that it takes a lot of time to find your way in a new society. And the same is true for native populations. When you start with categories like racism, xenophobia, it makes you feel good, eh, to call other people ignorant, but it doesn't help at all.
The last question here on the...
Hi, my name is Lilia, and I'm from Latvia, and I currently study at the University of London. I guess I have a question about integration, because it was raised a couple of times in this whole conversation with both speakers, and it's a buzzword among politicians everywhere, but it doesn't really have a definition. Considering it's been around since the early 20th century, it still doesn't have any definition at all, so we kind of interpret it in different ways in different countries. So I guess it goes for both speakers. I just want to know, what is your version of integration? How would you define it? Maybe you would use a different word like accommodation. And most importantly, do austerity measures have an impact on it? Well, it does, I think, in my opinion, because people who are poor, I don't think it's their priority to integrate with both societies. They're probably trying to survive.
Firas? So what do you think about integration?
Okay, like, I heard that always here in Germany. A lot of people all the time told me, hey, Firas, you are very integrated here. You are very integrated here. And I asked myself, what I changed in myself since I come here? What did change in me that people tell me now that I'm integrated here? And I figured out, like, integration, it's it's not about course you did it, or it's not about you say, I want to integrate myself in this society. Integration, it's when you accept the other people as they are, and if you don't accept them, you ignore them. If something I don't accept it, I don't attack it. I don't talk about it. I just ignore it. And if I accept everyone as they are, then people will accept me as I am. That's for me kind of integration. This is the integration for me. And as long as there is also people in Europe, in Europa, or in Germany, don't accept the other people, the refugee or the Muslims or whatever, they don't accept the other, so we can't have a real good integration here. So for me, it's like integration, it's from the both side, that when everyone accept the other, then we could do something good for ourselves and for the countries.
I have a different view. I don't accept people at face value. When I come across attitudes that are deeply troubling, in my view, or perhaps intolerant ideas, I would be critical. So for me, integration is always an effort of self-criticism on all sides. It's an invitation to live up to ideals, which are easy to formulate, but very difficult to practice, of equal treatment, open-mindedness, you know, freedom of speech, freedom of religion. So for me, it's very simple. When a society asks migrants to integrate, the question always comes back, integration into what? I would say into a culture of a shared citizenship. That sounds abstract, is very concrete. It starts with language. You know, if you don't speak the language, you cannot have an impact in a society. So in the Netherlands, it was often said to migrants, you shouldn't learn a language, it's not so important. Dutch, you know, who speaks Dutch? Learn English or something meaningful. But it was basically, the subtext was, you will never be part of this society. Because it's so obvious, if you don't speak the language, you cannot influence the society. Second, very easy, what is it you need to know as a citizen? So we have seen reforms of our schools. You know, what is it you need to know about history, about law, etc. And then all the critical questions come back to a society. For example, in the Netherlands, colonial history. Why haven't we talking about that so much in the schools? Third element, participation. If you don't work or don't participate in volunteer work, it's very difficult to find your way. And the most important element of citizenship is the normative question, what do we really expect in a normative sense of our fellow citizens? I would say, you know, in a normative sense, I would think that people should treat each other as equals. But that's a high moral challenge in the end. That is not accepting everybody as he is, but trying to suggest to each other, if you ask respect, give it to others. But what is respect? You know, respecting is really quite difficult because, you know, how can I respect somebody who says, I ask for respect, but I condemn homosexuals, I condemn people with other views of the world, I condemn Muslims for being Muslim. That's very difficult. So if we really challenge each other as citizens to live up to a higher ideal of really shared idea of equal treatment in the full sense of the word, that is not accepting the world as it is, but that's a high and difficult challenge, but I wouldn't know any other thing that we can suggest.
We are now running out of time, but I have still one question left. And I'm sorry, it's too late. So we have one more question because she's waiting for a long time. But please be short, and then we should. No? Would you like to have mine?
It doesn't work?
Oh,
yeah,
yes.
Okay. Well, I agree that no one can touch our freedom of speech, but my freedom of speech is I can affect my friends, and I'm not sure about that. But when it comes to media are very powerful organizations. And sometimes they end up reproducing ideology of who is the proper human. Like, do you remember the sketch of Aylan Kurdi at Charlie Hebdo? It was last year, and it was like, what would have become Aylan Kurdi if you had grown up? A rapist. So what what we are going to deal with the media when they end up, when they repress the already repressed, when they humiliate the already humiliated, when they instrumentalize the other. So I think it's not that easy in saying like, no, don't regulate the media, because in some cases they just end up reproducing racism and fascism. Instead of enhancing democracy, they just do the other thing. And you know, they have a bigger audience that they can affect, and then we just end up here discussing with each other about not racism, but what, so in this, sense, I fundamentally disagree with you by not regulating. Regulation is very sensitive, but we have to be critical, and we have to find a way that it's not said no regulation at all, because then we can't even become critical in terms of the media.
Yeah, but Thank you. With regulation, I mean, there are of course all kinds of financial regulation. What I want to suggest is that what you call racism, somebody else might find completely genuine articulation of an interest. So we should be very careful not to say who is going to draw the lines. So I can say that the media are also stimulating empathy. For example, the picture of this young boy, you know, dead on the coast, you know, has given a great impetus for many people to be engaged. So media are you know, making something, stories bigger, but also stories that really lead to shared emotions. So, you know, and the media doesn't exist. The media is a very pluralistic, very contradictory. Now it's the social media. There's a lot of, you know, going back and forth, a lot of arguments flowing through the air. So I wouldn't say, you know, if I look at our newspapers, for example, on the whole, Europe still has a lot of quality newspapers, quite good television. There's a lot of social media, so it's a very pluralistic landscape. And I would really be very afraid of those who call for regulations in the name of the fight against racism. You know, let arguments and counter-arguments find their way. And I wouldn't like to forbid also, you know, those who have radical views of Sharia, who would like to propose Sharia in Europe. Let them articulate their views and let it be contradicted. Words against words is so much more a peaceful solution than trying, in the name of what actually, trying to curb the freedom of speech. Have a little bit of confidence in the self-correcting mechanism of an open society.
Thank you, but we're missing still the question of the power.
Okay, but we have to close we have to close the session now. I'm very sorry. First of all, thank you, Firas, for joining us, and we wish you all the best to find your passport and your papers.
Thank you very much, and it was my pleasure to be with you guys. Thank you.
And thanks to all, and now there is a little break.